we are, the four of us, very interested in what work is going to mean in the rest of the 21st century. There's going to be some jobs that go away because of innovation. There are going to be new jobs that arrive because of innovation, and that some jobs are just going to keep going the way they have in the past. The question is which, and if some people don't have jobs because of innovation, can they do the new ones? If they can't, what should we do about it? And so that's the substance of the discussion today. I have my panelists come up. Please join me here on the stage. We are going to discuss this topic. I've asked each of the panelists to say a little bit ahead of time about their view on this question. And then we have a discussion among ourselves. Please come. And then we have a chance for you to interact with us as well. So let me just say, I'm not going to do a big, long introduction of my panelists, but on my far left and on your right is David Nordfors, whom you will by this time know is my co-conspirator in the Innovation for Jobs program. Some of you will have seen the book that he and I authored recently. He has given a lot of thought to this problem. Second, to my immediate left, is Francis West, who's chair of the Strategy and Development Committee of the G3 ICT in the USA. Francis has given a great deal of thought to the effects of ICT on the way people work, and so we're hoping to get some insight from her knowledge and experience from there. And finally, I have on my right Ivo Correa, who is the Policy and Communications Director for Latin America from Uber, which has itself introduced major innovations around the world, disrupting old business models and forcing us to think about new ones. So I'm going to start by asking David, please, to open our discussion.
I should say Vint and I had a book signing before with this I4J, Innovation for Jobs, book, Disrupting Unemployment, it's called. And if you want to buy this book, you have to do it on Amazon now because unfortunately we printed too few books and we ran out of all of them here. But it is available on Amazon. So what is I4J? I4J is like a thought leadership network, pretty informal, that Vint and I started a few years ago because we thought that everybody's discussing how innovation is going to kill all jobs. Shouldn't we have a possibility to discuss how innovation can create jobs? And this is what we've been doing for some years and collected a lot of thoughts. We have like an emailing list between us, and I think we've had like 4,000 posts in 1 year from these people. So it's really good. So I recommend you to buy this. So let's look. By the way, I should also say in I4J, we have different opinions here. So what you're going to see here now is not the official opinion from I4J, but my own point of view of this, and Vint might have somewhat different points of view, and the same goes for the other people in I4J. So, yes, let's talk about the economy. Today we live pretty much in a task-centered economy, which is about lowering the cost of tasks. We innovate to help people spend better. So we serve the spenders with innovations. And the strategy is then for people who have companies that we want to pay less to workers and sell cheaper to the customers. Okay? So problem here is that, of course, as the government sees it, the worker and the customer is the same person. You need to earn money in order to spend money. It's a well-kept secret among macroeconomists that they haven't shared with microeconomists who don't care about how people earn their money, just how people spend it, right? So this means that the public-private incentives are not aligned in the task-centered economy, and we see how there is an incentive to to kind of replace people with robots. Okay. Now, I will suggest that if we do a little mind shift here, there are actually two ways we can earn money on, right? We can earn money by lowering the cost of tasks, but we can also earn money by raising the value of people. Okay? So that would be innovation to help you earn money. And the worker is now my customer and the capital. And I can explain it like this. Let's say that I have a company, I come to you, and I say, I'll offer you a job that's tailored to fit your skills, your talents, your passions. I'll match you with people that you like and want to work with. I'll give you meaningful tasks, and you will be working with customers you can communicate with. You work whenever you want, not otherwise. I'll give you double as much as you earn today, and I'll take 20%. Do you want to have it? And many people will say yes. I'm now offering you a service of earning a living. This is, I am an entrepreneur. A job is a service for earning a living. And I can do this because I have all the computer power in the world to profile you, to look for whatever work that is out there. Work like Uber and so on, that's for me a spot market for paid work. And I assemble that into jobs for my customers, you, the workers. And I might educate you with courses because then I can charge more for you. You earn more, I earn more. We have aligned incentives. Now for me, the customer is the worker and the capital. And that's actually what goes for governments too. The customer and the worker are the same people, and the people of the country are the capital of the country. So now with the people-centered economy, actually government and private business are perfectly aligned. And this means basically that labor policy would turn into innovation policy. They would be the same in this economy. So let's look at the market for this then. This is the global workforce today. You have 5 billion. You have 5 billion people who are adults and want to have a job. Who are adults. You have 3 billion people who work somehow, earning money. Most of them want an employment. They have families, they want security, they want to bring up kids. Most people want employment. So out of the 3 billion who have an employment, only 1.3 billion have one. Okay? So these are the lucky ones. So let's look at them. Out of the lucky guys who have an employment, there are actually only 200 million of these 1.3 billion are engaged in their work and like it. Then you have 400 million who hate their job and they go to work just to destroy for others. So for every engaged person, there are two people who hate their job. And the rest, they go there in order to sit out the day, right? So this is the global workforce and it generates value, market value for $100 trillion a year. So let's switch over to the people-centered economy, right? And my company now is serving you. My competitor is a service for earning a living, is the incumbent service called employment, and you see it doesn't have very great ratings, and it can't even satisfy the market. So if I would manage to use all the computers and so on to find people's talents or whatever and match it with needs or even create needs so that we have 3 billion people who have tailored jobs and who are engaged at work. Question, how much more value will that workforce create every year? If I say $200 trillion, it's obviously very conservative because we know the difference between people who are engaged at work and people who are not. So it's also good for the world economy because people earn more money and then they spend it on each other. So it kind of drives the economy. So the difference between those two is the untapped market for innovation for jobs. So I am, I'm rounding off now. So here's the punchline. 3 billion customers want a good job. And we are now with I4J working on getting venture capitalists and entrepreneurs who are interested in developing this market and also governments. So if you're interested in that, you can get in touch with us.
Okay, thank you, David. You can hang on to that microphone. Francis, would you like to offer your initial views on this subject?
Thank you. Good afternoon. So I actually just recently retired from IBM as IBM's Chief Accessibility Officer. For those of you who don't know about accessibility, this is actually a topic in IBM that we've been working on for over a decade. In relation to the workforce discussion here, it has always been IBM's belief, and tying back to what Dave was saying, that workforce creates innovation, and therefore it's not an accident. IBM actually hired the first blind scientist in 1914.
Wow.
And we believe that, and some of you probably know about Via Voice, which is a technology for text-to-speech, that again was developed by our scientists for the for people with a hearing impairment. So I became the IBM Accessibility Officer managing a group actually out of IBM Research. Many people look at accessibility based on American Disability Act as an initiative that's really HR or even compliance based. And because in the United States, we have procurement law like Section 508. In Europe, we have EU 376. And I recently worked with the Chinese government on their procurement policy, which trying to enable accessibility into the government procurement actions. However, from IBM perspective, from day one, we view this as a differentiation, as a business initiative. So give you two of the examples. So my team is, for example, responsible for putting all IBM or tracking all IBM's hardware, software, services in the system. And recently, we were able to win a NASA contract into the billions. And the two number one reasons that NASA gave in terms of the IBM's differentiation was on our environmental actions and also on accessibility.
Wow, cool.
So that's a government contract differentiation. Another example, TD Bank. TD Bank has a model, we are the most accessible bank in every sense of the word. So for example, their banking hour is longer than, let's say, Bank of America. And we were the first one to help TD Bank to work their website so that they can be fully accessible to anybody. And we have done a research with Forrester. If your website is fully accessible, meaning you actually engage your customer, allow them to, for example, change simple things like font size or color contrast, in today's language, actually is about customer experience. So I would say that accessibility is not a compliance or legal topic. It really is in the forefront of a customer experience, or I would even say is actually extreme personalization. If we believe that accessibility is using technology to enable individuals, then I think with all the disruption of technology like virtual reality, augmented reality, big data, mobile, then that means that we are actually at the beginning or the cusp of truly taking technology and respect and honor individual differences. So from that perspective, I think the workforce of the future is going to be engaging people with a different kind of perspective, because we're moving from what we call the kind of efficiency model to a customer experience model. So that means that we actually have an opportunity to really engage people with a different perspective because you need a variation in terms of understanding the customer experience. So on that note, I think women, last week I was in New York City giving a talk to a women in technology. I think that the fact that we're moving into this human-centric and human experience world, we can begin to see more women wanting to get into technology because they really care about, you know, individual experience. Then we also can see people with disability, which is a constituency that I serve. Again, historically, people view it in disability as a kind of a one-off audience. But how many of you are over age 50 in the audience? According to American Association of People with Disability, if you're over age 50, you're going to have at least one disability. Usually it's your vision. You need glasses. If you take off your glasses, you're legally blind. By the time you're 60, you're going to have two. Your hearing begin to go. By the time you're 70, you know, everything goes.
Okay, let's be a little careful about this age thing.
So what I'm saying is by 2050, there will be 2 billion people over age 50. In China, it will be over 365 million. That's the entire population in the United States. So all the governments, include especially China, Japan, Spain, Italy, they're all looking at long-term, you know, economic issue and challenges associated with aging. So I think this is we're at the cusp of a very different workplace dynamics. We're going to have to deal with, not deal with, we're going to welcome participation with different constituency in technology, like women, like people with disability. So this is actually a very exciting time.
So thank you very much, Frances. I want to just emphasize two things. The first one is, David, when we get into discussion, I want you to talk about cool abilities, okay? And the second thing is that what Frances just said, you should read in very large letters about inclusive societies that allow people the opportunity to have the dignity of work and the opportunity to contribute to the society across all sectors. That's what I think we should be striving for. So now we're going to hear from Evo, whose company has basically blown up some of the older business models. This is what innovation often does. Evo is going to give his talk in Portuguese. So those of you who don't happen to speak Portuguese, including me, should be wearing your headsets. You have a headset over there. Good. So Evo, please, the mic is yours.
Yeah. Thanks, Vin. I'll start by apologizing to Vin, David, and Francis, but being a Brazilian in Brazil, I thought I should speak in Portuguese. Boa tarde, todo mundo. Prazer estar aqui. Queria agradecer desde já o convite, os organizadores. Eu tinha uma apresentação, eu não vou utilizar para a gente ganhar tempo para a conversa. Talvez eu mostre um slide só. Acho que a maioria de vocês conhece o Uber pela atividade básica, que é mobilidade, transporte ao toque de um botão. Push a button, get a ride. Desde que o Uber, através da tecnologia, passou a fazer o ride sharing, o compartilhamento de carros, o compartilhamento de viagens, uma coisa ao alcance de todos, acessível, confiável e segura, a gente tem ficado cada vez mais fascinado com as possibilidades que o ride sharing pode trazer para a transformação das nossas cidades e transformação também das nossas vidas. Acho que o exemplo mais óbvio de transformação das cidades é o impacto, e é o que a maior parte das pessoas conhece. Eu vou mostrar os slides, mas não falarei sobre eles, vou mostrar alguns. O mais óbvio impacto é claramente a questão de carpooling, né, o compartilhamento de carros, que é uma prática antiga, todos nós pegávamos caronas, compartilhamos carros, mas que antes não conseguia ganhar escala com impacto na cidade, porque era uma dificuldade, você tinha que combinar com as pessoas, tem um custo de transação enorme, e o Uber Pool, que é um dos serviços que o Uber oferece, acaba resolvendo isso através da tecnologia, através do aparelho que todos nós temos nos nossos bolsos, consegue rapidamente fazer o carpooling virar uma prática muito comum na maior parte das grandes cidades do mundo. Então, eu só vou citar, desde 2014 para cá, a gente já fez 250 milhões de viagens de Uber Pool, o que significa menos carros nas ruas, mais gente, portanto, os impactos para trânsito e poluição são enormes. Agora, não só o impacto sobre as cidades é importante, mas o impacto sobre a vida das pessoas que estão nessas cidades. E aí eu chego no ponto da nossa conversa. As oportunidades econômicas também, que as plataformas tecnológicas, as novas tecnologias podem criar. Acho que nesse público aqui, e nessa mesa em especial, eu não preciso gastar muito tempo tentando fazer um ponto de que nós, do Uber, não vemos a tecnologia como uma ameaça para as pessoas, uma ameaça econômica, mas sim uma oportunidade para novos desafios, novas oportunidades econômicas, novas oportunidades de trabalho. Do nosso ponto de vista, é óbvio, como o Vint colocou no início da nossa conversa aqui, é claro que a tecnologia elimina alguns tipos de trabalho, mas cria muitas outras oportunidades. Eu venho aqui falar um pouco das oportunidades que a gente vê desde o ponto de vista do Uber. Poderia estar falando de outras plataformas. Acho que há inúmeras plataformas tecnológicas que estão criando oportunidades diferentes. Se a gente pensar, usando o Google como exemplo, se a gente pensar o YouTube, quem imaginaria, anos atrás, que haveria uma profissão que é YouTuber, que no Brasil é super popular entre as pessoas mais jovens, que ganham muito dinheiro e fazem uma atividade super interessante, tendo um canal, sendo dono de um canal do YouTube. Ou se a gente olha para a Amazon, se a gente olha para Etsy, eBay, enfim, são inúmeras empresas que, justamente por reduzir os custos de transação, justamente por colocar, como dizia o David, colocar os consumidores, os clientes, os usuários e quem deseja fazer negócio diretamente em contato, diminuir e fazer essas transações serem mais fluidas, mais fáceis, mais seguras, acabam alavancando uma série de oportunidades econômicas. Do ponto de vista do Uber, eu acho que tem duas grandes maneiras como nós impactamos o futuro do trabalho e o futuro das oportunidades econômicas, o futuro da economia. Uma óbvia, a outra não tão óbvia. Vou começar pela não tão óbvia. O principal fator hoje correlacionado com a mobilidade econômica, segundo um estudo feito por professores da Universidade de Harvard, da Universidade de Stanford, não é a relação da pessoa com a pobreza e a possibilidade de ascender socioeconomicamente, não está relacionada necessariamente com o índice de criminalidade onde a pessoa nasceu e mora, com seus anos de escolaridade, mas o principal fator que eles encontraram como impacto para a mobilidade econômica, para a mobilidade social e econômica, é justamente o tempo de commuting, o tempo que a pessoa leva entre a sua casa e o seu trabalho. Por quê? Porque esse tempo significa qual é o número de oportunidades econômicas, qual é o número de oportunidades de trabalho que a pessoa vai poder acessar na sua cidade. Então, a primeira maneira como eu acho que o Uber tem impactado um pouco esse futuro da economia das cidades é ao melhorar a mobilidade, ao ajudar que a mobilidade das grandes cidades se torne mais fluida, que a gente tenha menos carros, menos trânsito, etc. Na verdade, nós estamos proporcionando para um grupo enorme de pessoas que elas possam acessar novas oportunidades de emprego, novas oportunidades de trabalho ou novas oportunidades de atividade econômica. Eu não vou gastar tempo aqui, mas só para vocês terem uma ideia, justamente o que eu estou mostrando aqui no caso de Nova York, podia mostrar em outras cidades, é que justamente nas áreas mais pobres é onde está uma demanda maior do que a média pelo Uber. Porque são lugares em que, em geral, o acesso ao transporte público é menor e o Uber cumpre essa função de complementar o acesso ao transporte. Então, nós estamos devolvendo às pessoas o direito sobre a cidade, cada vez mais poder acessar diferentes lugares e, portanto, diferentes oportunidades econômicas. A segunda maneira pela qual o Uber impacta diretamente o futuro do trabalho, e aqui acho que mais relacionado com a nossa conversa, é a mais óbvia, a criação de um número enorme de oportunidades para os nossos motoristas parceiros. Nós já temos mais de 1 milhão de motoristas no mundo todo, e eu só gostaria de... poderia falar... E eu acho que a única coisa importante para finalizar e começar a nossa conversa é um pouco sobre por que as pessoas dirigem para o Uber. Por que alguém decide dirigir para o Uber? Não é necessariamente pela questão econômica, não é pelo rendimento. Quando nós perguntamos num survey ou em vários surveys para os motoristas por que eles decidem dirigir para o Uber, as principais razões estão aí. As principais razões são ligadas à flexibilidade. As pessoas gostam de ser o seu próprio chefe, de poder escolher o seu tempo, de poder decidir se vão dirigir mais ou menos hoje ou na semana que vem. Ou seja, é um novo tipo de atividade, é muito diferente daquele trabalho tradicional das 9 às 6 da tarde, sempre cumprindo o mesmo horário, com as mesmas padrões, etc. Por que isso é importante? Acho que tem dois pontos que eu queria ressaltar e aí eu encerro a minha fala. O primeiro é porque isso vai ao encontro do que o David disse no começo. Quer dizer, as pessoas estão procurando por oportunidades de trabalho que não só deem valor, deem dinheiro para elas, mas que agreguem outras coisas. Nesse caso aqui, agreguem a possibilidade delas desenvolverem outras atividades. A pessoa pode complementar o Uber, usar como complemento de renda, ou pode usar o Uber enquanto tenta ser um empreendedor e criar sua própria empresa numa atividade específica. Enfim, você abre uma gama de possibilidades e ela não busca o trabalho só pela renda. O segundo ponto, que é o mais importante na minha opinião, é que isso permite o acesso para um grupo enorme de pessoas que tem muita dificuldade de encontrar trabalho tradicional das 9 às 6 por uma série de razões. Isso permite um acesso gigante para as pessoas. Eu estou falando aqui, em geral, de grupos que são menos favorecidos no mercado de trabalho. Então, mulheres, mães de família que podem dirigir para o Uber e cuidar da sua família, pessoas idosas, pessoas com deficiência. Enfim, acho que isso traz uma gama de diversidade para os motoristas do Uber, que também é muito interessante. Então, pensar o trabalho flexível, pensar o trabalho com independência, que abre essa possibilidade para uma gama muito maior de gente, acho que é um pouco o que a tecnologia nos proporciona e um pouco a discussão que a gente pode fazer. Obrigado.
Thank you very much, Ivo. So we're going to have a little. Now I'm listening to myself. I'm listening to myself speaking in Portuguese, and I'm wondering what I'm going to say next.
How do you sound in Portuguese?
Okay. So we're going to have a little discussion among ourselves, and then opportunity for some dialogue with you. I want to make one or two observations about what you've heard already. We've talked about jobs a lot. But one of the things that David and I discovered in the course of our several years of running the Innovation for Jobs Forum is that people were actually looking for meaningful work, even if they weren't being remunerated for it, even if they weren't being paid for it. There's a big volunteer economy in the United States. We don't really quite know how to measure that, but I expect it may be similarly true elsewhere. That's an important part of our economy. So this meaningful work is a very critical notion that we don't want to forget about. Francis brought up this really important point about inclusiveness, and I wanted to ask David to tell us a little more about an idea he has had. He calls it cool abilities in lieu of things like disabilities. So David, what's that all about?
Is this on?
Yes, it is now.
So, the idea with a people-centered economy is you raise the value of people, they earn more, you earn. Okay? So, what is the low-hanging fruit? Low-hanging fruit are the most undervalued people. So, find undervalued people, raise their value, and you earn. It's easier than to take overvalued people. So, what would be a good category of undervalued people? Well, women was brought up, they'd have the same skills as men and they earn less. But then we could think about people with disabilities. Now, we are used to thinking about people with disabilities about that they cannot do things. They don't get jobs because there are certain things they can't do that normal people can do. But often, together with a disability, there often comes a special ability. So people who are blind, their brains rewire the visual cortex and they get amazing abilities. They get sonar hearing or something like that. These are abilities that would be extremely valuable, but they don't get jobs because they can't see. We have people with autism spectrum disorder who have an enormous sense for detail, but they get overwhelmed, so they can't get jobs. And also difficulty with reading signals. But some of them can be very good programmers, and now they are even starting companies to employ specifically people with ASD. So they create some kind of work environment where autism spectrum disorder, the high functioning, is not disabling, but where they can leverage on their cool abilities, forgetting the disabilities. So it would be easier to take such a person from $0 a year to $100,000 a year than to take an engineer on the competitive market who gets $100,000 a year to $200,000. Ergo, better business for us. So we have this idea about, we don't want to talk about disabilities, we want to talk about cool abilities. We want to do research, which doesn't exist today, about what the cool abilities are. We know with autism spectrum disorder which kind of cool abilities come with that, and with blindness, but with many other conditions, nobody has done research into it. They only know the disabilities. So that we want to do research there and find investors and entrepreneurs who can start companies for people with cool abilities.
Okay, thank you, David. So I can tell Frances is leaping out of her chair. What do you want to add to this?
Yeah, I just want to say that, of course, David and I start having this conversation. I think this cool ability kind of terminology he's using is tapping into a bigger trend in that I think we all, would you agree that we are going to a workplace environment where there's going to be lot more specialization. One would say it's going to be, you know, Uber specialization. And in the future world, because the technology is going to enable us to say, I specialize and I prefer to do this versus doing that. So what that means is that what you're going to do is you're going to begin to advertise your ability and your preference and your definition of a meaningful job. And then there's going to be an open e-market to do the matching. And in IBM, already seen that kind of a behavior happening in the consulting world. Because in the consulting world, what you do is you declare what you're good at, right? I'm a strategy consulting. I'm a program, you know, a project manager. So by defining the ability, and then you match it. And I couldn't agree more that the future work is not just about skills and talent. You're going to have to take a holistic view of where you are physically, because the distance matters, transportation or access matters. And again, if you use people with disabilities as a kind of use case, you study that one of the most difficult things for people to be employed for disability is transportation. They have to think ahead, how am I gonna get there? But if we can solve that kind of problem with Uber, with technology, and then you have specialized skill that you can advertise as a cool ability, then I think this is actually a model of a general workplace phenomenon.
So I really like what Frances is saying, because she's touched on something I hadn't quite put together. Information and communication technology should be one of the most enabling technologies imaginable. What's the most adaptable thing you can think of? It's a programmable device. The trouble is that a lot of us, including you and me, haven't really taken advantage of that. We have not designed and built systems that are adaptable enough for people with disabilities or cool abilities to take advantage of this technology. But I love what Frances has done, because she's just taken the ICT part and the communications, commuting part, and put the two together. I would argue this is another way of using information and communication technologies in an enabling fashion. So I don't know whether I actually want to go off to a different topic, unless you're bursting to speak on this point.
That's good.
What I am very interested in hearing from you, especially, is whether you see the self-driving car phenomenon as something which is disrupting your business model, or whether it's a business model that you, in fact, can take advantage of. So can you speak to that?
Yeah, sure. Ben,
I didn't warn him that I was going to ask him about this, so he's getting this one point blank.
Portuguese or English? Let's try English.
Oh, that's right. We're going to
Try in English. That's good. So I think on the point of self-driving cars, Ben, first of all, I think it's still, although we expect a lot from it, it's still a beginning of a process. I think it's really hard to predict how long this process will take. if you look back, I mean, mobile phones started like 30, 35 years ago, and we actually...
The first mobile phone was designed in 1973,
so
and it went into operation in 1983. So you're right, 33 years ago.
33 years ago.
Yes, so look how long it took to get to 2007
and
the smartphone.
Yeah.
Right.
That's my point. I mean, to get to a smartphone, so we are starting, and a bunch of companies, not only Uber, are doing a lot of experimentation, investing a lot in autonomous technologies for self-driving cars, but we still don't know how much time it will take. And we also don't know, and I like to use another example, we also don't know what's the real impact that this technology could have for people, because if you look at ATMs, when they also were developed, a lot of people thought that we wouldn't have like people in the banks, and now that's not the reality. And if you look to self-driving cars, of course, the driving part could be figured out by technology, but you still have a lot of things like loading the car, doing a delivery. So it's still something to be discussed. But I think that we have to look to that with a very with bright eyes, I would say. I mean, with a lot of hope, because currently we lose more than 1 million people in transit accidents in the world per year. So what we are talking here is about saving. For instance, if everything goes well and we have a technology that is perfect, saving more than 1 million people per year in the world. We're also talking about, for our OECD estimation, we're also talking about reducing the fleet in the different cities by for 10% of the current.
Because the cars are
so it's giving back. Going to my first point, it's giving back a lot of time to people, giving back the city. And if you look to the I was going to give an American example, but let's give you a Brazilian example. If you look to São Paulo, our largest city, we have 13% of the city is dedicated to, of the area of the city, is dedicated to parking zones. So we were talking about 13% of the city that could have other uses, either for the people, either for business. So we're talking, that's the kind of conversation we're starting to have. Besides the impact on the insurance side, on the vehicle production side, so I think it will disrupt not only our business model, but it will disrupt the way we see cities and we move around in the cities. But I think, as I said, I would look this with bright eyes. I said I think it will open a lot of new opportunities for people as well.
So here's an interesting thought: we're talking about how information and communication technologies can change the way in which we work. And one thing that has occurred to me is that you could work from home with adequate information and communication technologies, in which case the commute is walking down the stairs.
Yeah.
That's a lot less polluting than driving to work. So we can be looking for ways in which the technology will change our ability to carry out our work. Now, I'm very conscious of the fact that this thing says I have less than 8 minutes left. And I promised that I would try to give you guys in the audience a chance to at least say something. So could I ask the lights up so we can see you out there. Thank you. We've got some questions way in the back. We have a microphone. Now, I'm one of those disabled guys who's hearing impaired. So if you're going to ask the question in English, I'm going to need help. If you ask it in Portuguese, I have this fabulous translator that I can hear. So if you decide to ask in Portuguese, it would be really good. Can you?
I need to speak in Portuguese. Thanks. Bom, eu preocupado com essa questão do serviço no futuro, né? A gente tem aquela fala do Stephen Hawking, que diz que se não houver distribuição de riqueza, nós viveremos uma distopia. E, caso contrário, nós estaremos vivendo o céu, né, o paraíso. Porque as máquinas farão todos os trabalhos, não só aqueles trabalhos braçais, mas serão melhores médicos, melhores advogados, melhores engenheiros, programadores. E a gente tem essa escolha para fazer, talvez, agora. Nós já temos exemplos como o CodeFage, uma iniciativa lá do MIT, para quem não conhece, que consegue consertar automaticamente os softwares. Vazou da Tesla uma informação de que A Uber iria comprar 250 mil carros automáticos da Tesla se ela desenvolvesse a tecnologia até 2018. Então, parece que essa tecnologia pode chegar muito mais rápido que a gente vai ter tempo para comportar, para se, né, se preparar para elas. Eu vejo esse lado também ruim da tecnologia, e eu acho que a gente está fazendo pouco para nos precaver, para a gente ter uma sociedade que se beneficie mais dessas questões. Eu queria saber o que você acha, principalmente você, Sérgio.
Okay, so my reaction, now I'm listening to myself in Portuguese again. I'm actually very optimistic. I am not pessimistic. I don't agree with Stephen Hawking. I don't agree with Elon Musk. I think that artificial intelligence is being given too much of a boogeyman character. I know a little bit about programming. I know a little bit about how we do artificial intelligence, and I can tell you it's fairly narrow. So when you see a computer playing chess, or you see our AlphaGo program playing Go, believe me, just because you can play Go well does not mean you can reason logically about general problems. It's not the same. There is a dearth of real-world knowledge that the computers do not have. You know, if you ask the computer, what's the fastest way to get from the third floor to the first floor, it would probably tell you to jump out the window. What it doesn't know is that when you land, you may not survive. So, and I don't mean to make fun of the question because it's an important issue, but everything that we have learned at Google so far is that the artificial intelligence that we've been able to create has turned out to be something we engage with. It is assisting us. It is not threatening us. And I think it's going to be that way for a very long time to come. Whenever you do a Google search, when you use Google Translate, when you use Google Maps and Waze, you are using artificial intelligence, but it is your helper. It is not a threat. And so for me, I'm not worried. I think that we are, in fact, going to go down a very fruitful path. So I don't know if my fellow panelists want to react to that. It's that David does, okay.
Yes, so I'd say that an economy happens when people need and want each other and can satisfy each other's need and want of each other. If they need and want each other more, the economy grows. If they need and want each other less, the economy shrinks. So we need to have innovation that makes people need and want each other. And I think that we need to have invest in technology that brings people closer together to help them need and want each other in new ways. And if a machine does one thing, then we have to put and takes away something so people don't need to do it. We should invest in finding new things that we want to have from each other. So I think that we should stop seeing each other as kind of human machines that do things and get used to the thought that machines can do things. And I think maybe we should see each other more as human beings and want each other for that reason, and that we kind of think of that there's not only an economy around money, there's also an economy around emotions, which doesn't yet included in the numbers. So I think that maybe we should invent an emotional economics and try to maximize that.
Well, thank you, David. We take one more question, I think, and that's all the time. There's a gentleman over there. Are you going to be asking in Portuguese or English? Oh, somebody else got the microphone. I apologize. Okay, hang on.
Can I ask a question then? Because I have a microphone.
I can't hear this very well.
Hello?
Hello?
Can you hear me? Okay,
okay, so he's going to have to take the question because I can't hear you well enough. Go ahead.
Well, my question is, so when you go and see governments and policymakers, how do you respond to their two reactions, which I think is, one, this is upsetting current systems, current regulations, current labor policies. So it's upsetting what we've had, what we have, and then they ask, okay, this is new, how do we regulate it?
She's basically asking, as a policymaker, how we deal with the disruptiveness of new technology because it's changing the current.
Okay, so this is the, thank you very much, by the way. That is probably policy question number one for anyone in the government responsible for innovation and new technology. There are several answers to this, and my colleagues may have more. First one is education. The only way we are going to help people adapt to new technology is to make sure that they can get the education they need to use that technology and put it to work. Those of you who, like me, grew up where you went to school for a certain number of years, then you had a job, and then you retired, that model is gone. People being born today are going to live for 100 years and have multiple careers. They are going to need to learn throughout the courses of their careers, so we really have to put education at the top level. The second thing that we need to do is to be conscious of exactly the concern you're raising and try to think ahead of what the impact will be on jobs that the technology introduces. To be honest, sometimes you can't know for sure what a new technology is going to do, and so you have to pay attention to that. Now, I'm going to start over here. This is our last response, and so I give you a chance first, Ivo. Yeah.
Well, from my side, as a policy guy, I think what I really like your question. I thank you for that. And what I would say, just complementing what Finn said, is that regulation really matters. So the policymakers, the kind of decision they take could enable innovation, enable new technology, or could completely kill it. And I think this so education is number one, as Vin said, but I think you should be very careful in treating this. We should have always be concerned in leaving some openness to the new, right? We'll very hardly predict everything that's coming. So we have to leave some space for the new and for the innovation there. Otherwise, regulation can completely kill what's coming next. And I could give you examples, I can talk later.
I'm a big fan of being very open to innovative ideas. Francis, last thoughts on this.
So since we're talking about jobs and employment, I think this is one area that especially policymakers really need to reach out to the private sectors, because in many cases that's where the jobs is being created. And I also think that there needs to be a lot more research, a joint research with the private sector versus with academia. At least in the accessibility area, the government around the world spends lots of money working with the universities, but the ultimate goal is to get people with disability employed, and then workplace employment technology is actually with private sectors. So there seems to be a missing link here. So what I've been doing in my prior job and also trying to do here along with people on this panel is to really to begin to push for the policymaker to understand that how important it is to engage the private sectors in the innovation side, not just accommodation, not just assistive technology, mm-hmm. but on innovation.
Right. David, 2 minutes, and that's all the time we have. 2 minutes.
Right. So Francis pushes the point here that cool abilities is extreme specialization, personalization. That's quite right. We're all unique. We don't get jobs because we are unique today. But we can in the future, because there only needs to be 20, 30 people among the 5 billion people in the world that want you for what you are special at. And we want to find the entrepreneurs, venture capitalists, and governments that will create the technology so that those 20 people can start bidding for this very special thing that you have. We could never do it before. So we're looking for investors, companies, entrepreneurs, governments who want to get together and invest in raising the value of people as a business instead of just making things cheaper.
Thank you very much. David, would you join me in thanking the panel? Okay.